Man, the Supreme Court's really in the spotlight this season. Another one where it seems that the Obama administration is on the opposite side of where the court is leaning. This time it's Arizona's immigration law. The Justice Department said, oh, it's unconstitutional. The High Court doesn't appear to agree with that.
Well, Ephraim Graham has this look at what's behind the law and how the justices reacted to the administration's case against it.
At the heart of the case, America's porous borders. State and local officials say rising illegal immigration has led to rising crime against their citizens.
We've been in a pitched battle down there. It's only going to increase and grow. I think a lot of people are waiting to see what's going to happen before they creep back into the country, some that have left.
That's why the state of Arizona made an immigration law of its own. It allows law enforcement to check the immigration status of anyone they suspect is in the U.S. illegally during routine traffic stops. Opponents of the law say it targets Latinos, and the Obama administration agreed, blocking Arizona's law, sending it to the Supreme Court.
We should not have laws in which 50 states have 50 different ways of treating immigration policy, especially laws that can only be enforced by making judgments on whether you have dirt on your boots, the color of your skin, the accent of your voice, or your last name.
But supporters of the law say it is simply a copy of the existing federal law against illegal immigration. So the real issue, can Arizona enforce the law when the federal government is refusing to?
Merely allows the state and local authorities to enforce federal law. The federal government and this administration should be embracing that cooperation.
Even liberal justice Sonia Sotomayor, the first Hispanic on the high court, seems skeptical of the Obama administration's arguments. She told the Solicitor General, "You can see it's not selling very well. Why don't you try to come up with something else?" Meanwhile, Senator Chuck Schumer says if the Supreme Court upholds the law, he plans to overturn it through Congress. He says he'll pass legislation that will block states from passing their own immigration laws. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Thanks, Ephraim. Jay Sekulow was at the court for the hearings, and Jay is the chief counsel of the American Center for Law and Justice. And Jay, what's your take? You heard
It was a great day for the state of Arizona. It was a great day for our side. We represent a large number of Congress, as well as a lot of the Arizona delegation. So it was a big case for us. But Pat, I think the two most telling things were, number one, all the discussion about the Arizona immigration laws focused on this concern over racial profiling or ethnic profiling.
Yeah.
The first question that the Chief Justice, John Roberts, asked Varelli, that's the Solicitor General of the United States, was, this case has nothing to do with racial profiling or ethnic profiling, does it? He said, absolutely not. That's not an issue in this case. So that was a huge concession. In fact, that concession in and of itself set up for the next series of questions, right, which then came from Justice Sotomayor, which you would think would be someone that would not really be too keen on the Arizona law. She said to the Solicitor General, I'm confused by your answer. And then she went on to say, the fact is, she said, no one is buying this idea that the state of Arizona has no ability or capacity or right to enforce existing law. And the federal law and the state law mirror each other here.
Yeah.
So what happened was you had this sense that the government, the United States government, had one shot, and that was going to be, this is our jurisdiction, everybody else stays out of the way. And all of the justices seem to reject that out of hand. Now, when they get back and they vote, you never know exactly how it's going to happen. But the good news is the oral argument went very well, and Paul Clement, again, did an incredibly great job. He's had a busy 2 months.
Borelli's got egg all over his face.
He's a good lawyer.
Is he?
Who, and I'll tell you what it is. As someone that does a lot at the Supreme Court, I always have, and you've been up there when I've done them, I always have an escape hatch. You always have a way out of a case. And if you got objections from justices, you give them another approach. They are ideologues. And because they're ideologues, they're not thinking through. So they have their position, and that's it. Remember the president made the statement, Pat, it made some news back when he made it. I don't want some kid picked up in an ice cream store because of their race, because of the immigration law of Arizona. And that's what's going to happen. Again, racial profiling. But then the first words out of the Solicitor General's mouth are, this has nothing to do with racial or ethnic profiling. Yeah. It's a question of, can the states actually engage this issue? And there was a great question asked by Justice Alito, where he said, if there were, and which has been a problem, if there was civil unrest in Arizona because of the border drug wars and these kind of things that are happening, are you telling me the state of Arizona cannot enforce the existing laws in order to stop that kind of unrest? And they were dumbfounded. The government was didn't want to answer that question. Also, the government conceded they didn't have the resources for enforcement, that some of the illegal immigration is not a priority for enforcement purposes.
They said all that.
All of that. So it was that's why you saw all the major media saying this was a big day for Arizona, big day for Governor Jan Brewer.
Well, as I understand, Arizona law mirrored the federal law, and they
exactly.
said basically we're going to enforce the federal laws.
Enforcing the federal law that the federal government acknowledged yesterday at the Supreme Court, they don't have the resources to enforce. So that became the entire case, which ends up being not really a big issue. If that's all that's at stake, I think, you never know until you get the decision, but I'm really optimistic. But this is a trend with this administration. The Solicitor General's taking these positions and are forcing themselves into this box. Now, again, you never know how the justices will actually vote, but based on the question yesterday, when Justice Sotomayor, it was a big headline on a lot of the papers, I'm confused by your, and now you have me really confused. It tells you that was not getting the answer she wanted. Justice Kagan recused herself from that case, so she wasn't there, but it was quite the... hour and 20 minutes. Case went longer than anticipated.
Well, is Kennedy again? Is he a swing vote, or you think there'll be a majority?
You know, I'm not so sure. I mean, I think Justice Kennedy clearly had trouble with the government's argument, the federal government's argument. But I'm not so sure he's the swing here because I'm not so sure it's that close.
Okay.
Like I said, you never know. But based on he didn't ask a lot of questions. Just he asked a few. His questions were very pointed, and again, focusing on the enforcement. Everybody acknowledged that this is not a new law being created. That this is simply a systematic enforcement mechanism. That's what was at play here. And the end result of that is that should be a non-issue.
Well, basically, the law of the preemption is if the feds have a law and they're enforcing the law, the state can't put a law that contravenes that.
Of course.
That's the ruling.
Right, except this law was exactly mirrors the federal law with enforcement provisions on the state level. And then they made this argument, by the way, that the state law enforcement personnel were not properly trained. Well, that was absolutely defeated as an argument because they get tremendous amount of training.
Mm-hmm.
And you know that in the federal law, there's actually a statement where state law enforcement officials can call ICE, that's the Immigration Bureau, and check on status of someone. And all the law did in Alabama, you've got Georgia now, and of course Arizona, is five states have these laws. All they're doing is say instead of you can, you shall. They want them to call. They want the call to be made. But what it is, the federal government really doesn't want to remove the illegal immigrants here. And I'm the grandson of a legal immigrant to the United States. I like immigration when it's done correctly. But that's what this is really about. This is the ideological and political clash. We're just seeing it played out at the Supreme Court of the United States like we've never seen before.
Well, it's going to hurt them. I mean, this coming into the election is going to make a huge difference.
Yeah, and I'll tell you something, Pat. I think the Republicans are going to come with a very thorough immigration policy that's going to make sense.
Mm-hmm.
The administration is suing states. I mean, what people need to understand is federal dollars, our taxpayer dollars, were used to have the Department of Justice sue the state of Arizona while the Department of Justice was overseeing a gun running scheme into Mexico.
Yeah.
But they sue Arizona. Tells you where the priorities are.
Jay, thank you.
We'll know
you
at the
so
end of June.
Much. Well, end of June, both of those decisions will be coming
down.
All right. Well, Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories from the CBN Newsroom. Lee?
Well, Pat, Senator James Inhofe is going after the Environmental Protection Agency. The Oklahoma Republican showed a video on the Senate floor of an EPA regional administrator. In the video, Al Armendariz says his philosophy is to make examples of energy companies that aren't following the law. Armendariz says he believes in following the example of the Romans by, quote, crucifying those companies. Inhofe says not long after that, the EPA made inflammatory remarks against natural gas producers in three different cases without any solid scientific evidence. He's also investigating to see if the agency overstepped its authority. The EPA looked into a case involving an energy company in Texas before state regulators had finished their own investigation. Thousands of people have reportedly joined in a boycott of Groupon. Morality in Media launched the boycott of the coupon company. It says Groupon has offered discounts for tours of what it describes as a torture porn studio. And it says selling coupons supporting the degradation of women is as low as a publicly traded company can go. Morality in Media urges supporters to write the company and ask managers to stop supporting the porn studio. Groupon defends its work, saying, "We thoroughly vet the businesses we feature. This business has proven to be a responsible member of their community." A new trend may be emerging among some teenagers in this country, drinking hand sanitizers to get drunk. The popular disinfectant is 62% ethyl alcohol, and some use a distillation process to separate the alcohol. They're finding that on video online, instructional video showing the process and posting on YouTube. The potent amount of alcohol is sending many of those teens to the emergency room.
We have patients coming in to the emergency department with these kinds of signs and symptoms, slurred speech, lack of balance, changes in their mental state.
If kids don't realize how concentrated it is and take a large quantity of it, take a few shots, certainly kids can die from this.
Doctors are asking parents to be cautious. Getting high off household items, though, is not uncommon. Glue and cough syrup have also been used. Nowadays, many groups here in the U.S. try to keep the Bible and its message out of the public eye. But in Israel, the government there actually sponsors Bible-related events. Chris Mitchell has that story now from Jerusalem.
Dozens of Jewish teenagers from Israel, the U.S., and around the world came to Jerusalem to compete in the International Bible Quiz this year. Israel's first Prime Minister, David Ben-Gurion, started the competition. It's held on Independence Day each year, and questions are asked in Hebrew, with translation if necessary.
When you read the Bible, you read in what language? Spanish. Oy. Okay, that has to be corrected.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu met with the contestants.
So I want you to learn Hebrew, and I want you to come to Israel, because, you know, the Bible, the Tanakh, is not an abstract book.
Netanyahu says he studies the Bible with his sons on the Sabbath. His son Avner took third place in the competition 2 years ago. The young people were excited to be in Israel.
It's amazing. Like, everything is really amazing, a trip, and meet other people and like, be here with Netanyahu was like amazing.
Now that I studied the Bible and I've seen many places that are actually in the Bible, it's great seeing for real what you studied.
But Netanyahu told them it's not enough to just visit.
But I want you to actually come and live here, because this is a great adventure. Okay? It gives an opportunity for you, as young Jews, to be part of Jewish history and to make Jewish history.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Pat, back to you.
Isn't that great? That's a major thing. It's like the Super Bowl in Israel. It's a huge
Hebrew. Good grief!
Well, they have to translate. The kids, some of them don't speak Hebrew. Well, if you're going to study the Bible and really understand it, you really have to know what the Hebrew roots are, because some of the translations go away from what the original biblical text says. But hey, that's great. But that's the root of Israel. That is their Magna Carta, if you will. It's the charter that God gave them for their existence. And so the Jews should never run away from the Bible. And I'm glad that Netanyahu is embracing the heritage, the document that sets forth the charter of their being.
Mississippi's governor, had some harsh words for Democrats in his state on an internet talk show this week. Governor Phil Bryant said, quote, "Their one mission in life is to abort children, is to kill children in the womb." The House Democratic leader says Bryant's comments went totally too far. The comments come just days after the governor signed a law that could effectively shut down Mississippi's only remaining abortion clinic. The law requires doctors who perform abortions to be certified OBGYNs with admitting privileges at a local hospital. Megachurch pastor Joel Osteen opened the U.S. House of Representatives in prayer. He prayed that lawmakers would be mindful to honor God in their work.
Help these lawmakers to search their hearts so that they may serve with dignity and honor, and that through them our nation will achieve the destiny that you have set before us. Give them wisdom as they make good decisions, courage that they will hold fast to your truth, and compassion that all should prosper from their laws.
Osteen is pastor of Lakewood Church in Houston, Texas. He's in Washington for a Night of Hope, a stadium-sized event at Nationals Park this weekend. Well, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.